Welcome to the Sunshine Parenting Podcast. My name is Audrey Monkey, and I am your host. For more than three decades, I've been a summer camp director, and I've had the privilege of working with thousands of children, teenagers, young adult counselors, and parents. I really enjoy sharing stories, tips, and ideas to help others who care about young people raise a generation of kind, self-reliant, optimistic kids who become thriving adults. If you're interested in summer camp, parenting, or happiness, you've come to the right place. In episode 52, I'm talking with my great friend and fellow camp director, Sara Kuljis. We've done several episodes together, and on this one, we talk about post-camp or debriefing after every kind of different experience our children have. We offer some ideas on how to process things after they're over. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Well, hi, Sara. Welcome back to the podcast.
Thank you for having me. I love chatting with you.
So our topic today, we've covered lots of topics together, but this one is something that's close to our hearts. We both, as everyone, most people know anyway, that we're both summer camp directors. And for us, our summers have come to a close and kids have headed home. And one thing that Sara and I spend a lot of time talking about is how we can help kind of keep the benefits of camp going long beyond the couple weeks that the kids are with us during the summer. And so we thought today our topic is just sort of what can we do after camp or also after any other sort of new or challenging or different experience that our kids have. How can we as parents support that growth, keep it going, even after the experience is over? So this was really Sara's idea. We kind of talked about some different topics, but we had great interviews at the beginning of the summer about homesickness and preparing for camp. And so now this is kind of our wrap-up episode, the post-camp episode. So Sara, why don't you start with just sort of your first kind of advice that you give to parents after camp?
Well, thank you, Audrey. This is a big one for me. We all live in a very hurried pace these days, it feels like. Our days are full and long, and we also somehow schedule our kids' days to be full and long. And the more and more that I'm reading and learning and studying, the more research that comes out reminds us to create places to slow down and rest. And so after camp, whether your kiddos just come back or after any big new experience, I would really encourage parents to plan rest. And that might be straight up sleep, because sleep actually helps us make sense of our learning for the day, or just reflective quieter time where our kids can process what was important, what was special, how do I feel, what do these emotions mean. It does help, I believe, solidify the learning. It helps make the experience precious, and we don't lose so much of the experience by racing into the next class or concert or trip. So building in the downtime, I think, will help us raise our kids to have better balance even as young adults and older adults. Would you add anything to that, Audrey?
I just really agree. It's funny because as you were talking, I was remembering a counselor who was a former camper with us told me that, you know, we were talking about how sometimes you're a little bit sad after camp, but you're also really reflective. And she said every time her routine was to go home and go into her room for a couple hours and just think about camp and think about her friends. And it's that processing piece. And I think you're so right. I don't think we adults don't do it enough either if we're rushing from one thing to the next. So I love that idea of just, it's like the experience is so much richer when you take the time to process it. I'm reading this book right now that you actually have to read. It's called Off the Clock by Laura Vanderkam. And I'm telling you, it's so amazing. It talks about how ways you can make memories and time seem like it's lasting and not that you're not, don't have enough time. You know how we all are like, oh, we're so busy, I don't have enough time to get all these things done. Well, there are ways, and that way that you just described is one of the ways. If you have some amazing experience, take the time to reflect on it, because that makes it even better and it makes the positive part of the experience continue longer. So I'm really, really into this whole concept of just like, what's it called when you just like really savor or stay in moments longer? I love that one.
I spoke with a mom. We have a resident camp and we also have a day camp. And this wise mommy picked up her little guy at day camp. I think he's 6. And it was a bit of a drive home, like about 20 minutes from camp. And so she would have him draw on the way home. And he would kind of talk about his day and he would draw pictures of him in the climbing wall or him in the, at the beach. And it was, and then she collected these drawings. And I thought, even for a little 6-year-old to kind of just, you know, pour back out and remember and think through his learning and then share it with her. Sometimes he was quiet and he was humming and sometimes he was talking about it. He would draw the counselor in the costume he was in and then explain it to her afterwards. And I think that's a beautiful way, even for a little tyke, rather than rushing him to the next computer camp he's at or, you know, Taekwondo, those things are important too. But just to have that marinating and down and reflecting time, I think, is brilliant.
Oh my gosh, I agree. So what else have you thought of as good advice for post-camp or other fun experiences?
I really, again, children often don't get listened to well. We're interrupting them often and telling them what the next thing is they need to do, or at least I often am doing that. And so just really encouraging parents to listen to their stories from camp. And some of the stories come out weeks later. They'll hear a song or see someone that reminds them of something, or remember a funny moment. And I just all year long keep listening to those stories. And one of my favorite ways, I think I've mentioned this in another podcast, is to sit down with your child in front of the photos, if your camp posted photos, and pick a day and say, tell me about this. What was this? What was this? And really allow that child to fully tell you their story in their own words without interruption. It's really a way of honoring their experience. How did you carve out time, Audrey, to listen to your kids' stories?
Well, I think you kind of hit the nail on the head. I think for some of my kids, they just would, especially my girls, would just, I mean, they wouldn't stop talking. They would just like start sharing their stories and they would just go on and on and on. Whereas I noticed with my boys, they were more like, oh yeah, it was good. But then, you know, a few days later, something will come out. We're just sitting around. Often just, you know, you're like you said, driving around or at the dinner table or something. And like a week or two after camp, some fun story would come out that they hadn't shared like the day camp ended. So I think it's kind of being patient. And like you said, letting them lead a little more. I feel like kids have so little autonomy often, especially younger ones, in just getting to decide how and when they want to share. And maybe they want to keep these things to themselves for a while. It was this really independent experience. And maybe there's some things that they, you know, haven't all the way processed yet. And they want a little time before they share them with the outside world or your parents and all that.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's wonderful. Sometimes asking really thoughtful questions can also bring out some of those stories. What kinds of questions do you like asking kids after camp? Or what questions would you recommend parents ask kids after camp?
Well, as I told you, we both couldn't quite remember where it was. We had heard these three great questions for processing any challenging or new experience, but it was actually from our episode 3. So one of our earlier episodes, you shared these with me. Of course, you didn't remember that they were your brilliant idea, but I think these questions are really good and actually can go for any experience, not just camp. And your three questions are, the first one is, what did you really enjoy or love about the experience? The second one is, what was challenging about the experience, or kind of what did you learn maybe? How did you grow? And finally, when you do this thing again, what will you do differently, or how would you approach it differently? And I really like those because they're all open-ended questions. So they can't just say yes or no. They, you know, hopefully will lead to a story. But just my one caveat is I don't think a kid can get in the car after camp and you know, have these questions on an index card and read them. I think it just, if they could organically come out over a few weeks, but I like that they're positive focused. You know, they're asking for sort of the positive aspects of the experience. I know you had a really good and interesting thought, and I guess you and I both experienced this as camp directors, that, you know, inevitably a camp session ends and we get an email or two from a parent who has a complaint of some sort, that it's usually something that their child has told them. And, you know, of course we want parents to let us know about anything that was of concern. And we love to look into these things and follow up on them. And oftentimes they come with a very one-sided type of description where, you know, my kid said this and it's this really negative thing and, you know, we have to look into it. And oftentimes there's sort of another side to it and there's more going on. But what was that? You had a good description for what that's called when some parents sort of kind of focus more on asking, I guess, negative type things.
Yes. Well, I stole this phrase from Dr. Wendy Mogul, who's a speaker and researcher and author who we love. Blessing of a Skinned Knee and Blessing of a B Plus are her books. But she urges families, parents, not to always be interviewing for pain, which I think is a great line. Sometimes in our wonderful effort to prevent our kids from coming up against painful situations, we automatically interview for pain. What was bad about today? What didn't you like about the teacher? Who's mean on the team? And we focus in on the negative rather than reminding them that most things can be positive. Who did you love on the team? What did you like about the coach? What qualities made you want to work hard for her or for him? And some of those questions, like what accomplishment at camp are you most proud of? Or who were your favorite staff members and what about them made you like them? Or even what is something you saw in yourself at camp that you want to also be here back at home? Were you more inclusive? Were you braver? Or did you enjoy being grateful? Did you get up on stage and show your whole self? Did you find that you could be a really good friend? I think just really, like you said, looking at some of that positive stuff and helping our kids build resiliency through that, you know, that beautiful question asking.
Oh, I love that. It reminds me of the energy bus. I know I always talk about this, but just how much, you know, we can, by changing our attitude and our approach, how much different life is for us. And so even for our kids, it's a real gift to help them learn to focus on the good things, because no matter what experience we have, there's always going to be something that maybe didn't go well, you know, whether it's at school or with certain kids or on a team, but there's always things that went well as also. And so if we can train our kids to be more focused on the positive things, that's so helpful for them and for their well-being. You know, we're naturally inclined to see the negative. All of us are. It's just the way our brains are wired. And so it takes a little more work and effort to turn that around and be aware of, you know, in a room full of kids who are all going crazy, seeing the one that is helping a friend. You know, I always tell teachers, like, oh, if there's only one kid doing something right, point out that child. You know, say, hey, I noticed you listened right when I asked you to get out the spelling book. And all the other kids, you know, turn around, oh, maybe that's what I'm supposed to be. Instead of, you know, yelling about all the things going wrong, when you help kids see that you're seeing the good and you're helping them find the good, I just think that's a real gift that parents can give their kids. And like you said, it's just, I think we see that with camp a lot. Like, we'll get these evaluations from the kids. Like, they'll tell us about camp and how they had so much fun and they loved this activity and they really liked their counselors. And then we get a call from the parent saying that, you know, they're, you know, there wasn't the food that they wanted wasn't offered one day, or, you know, something, some kind of that it's like, wow, you know, yes, that happened, or that wasn't the best day of food or whatever it is. But was that the whole picture of the experience?
Yes. I remember even my own dad, who was a camp director for 50 years, he would say gently, "Do you want to hear the rest of the story?" To a parent when they had a piece of the story and they had an important piece. Mm-hmm. And usually there was some, you know, emotion and discomfort around that piece of the story. So that was all valid, but he would always gently say, do you want to hear the rest of the story? And they would work together to flesh out how to problem solve the issue or what the kiddo might have learned from it or how, you know, the camp even could do something different or better the next time around. And I appreciated how he approached that.
Oh my gosh, I love that. How about also that question with your child? Like if your child comes back and is complaining about a situation or a team or whatever, well, ask them, well, what else is there to the story? I want to hear some of the other parts of this story? What are the good parts of this story? I love that idea. Oh, your dad, so brilliant. That's so, so fun. Okay. So another thing that we talked about that is a way of keeping a positive experience going, like camp, is to think about if there's a ritual or a tradition or something that is done at camp that you can maybe try at home to sort of keep up the good stuff that the child is feeling as a result of that experience. So why don't you share about one of your, I love this tradition of yours, your flower Sundays and the story about how someone used that and took it home really in a big way.
Sure. Well, in the middle of our 2-week sessions, it's a Sunday in the middle of the sessions, and we have chapel time at camp. And then after chapel, all the campers and all the staff are given a daisy, just a very simple flower. And it's a time of affirming each other now that we've gotten to know each other for about a week's time. And every camper and staff member hands their flower to someone else and affirms them for a quality that they see in them, or maybe thanks them for something they've done. It might be, thank you for being my first friend when I got off the bus, or thank you for helping me get over my homesickness, or I really like how you always save a seat for me, or there's just so many sweet affirmations that have been exchanged between 8-year-olds and 16-year-olds and staff to kids. So we had a camper a few years back. She was 16 and heading back to Orange County, where she was on ASB at her school. And she introduced Flower Friday. And once a month, she would bring in carnations, sell them for 50 cents or a dollar with a little card. And she got the whole school grabbing a flower and handing to a friend with an affirmation of good qualities they had seen or gratitude they had seen. And to know that that little Flower Sunday affirmation had made it all the way back hundreds of miles away to a school and was really impacting the culture of that place, that was something that made me really proud. And she was just so smitten by the fact that everybody craves that everywhere. Mm-hmm. It was awesome.
That is just amazing. And also a way that for her, she has really taken like a lesson from camp and actually brought it to the world, which you and I often talk about that, you know, not everyone gets to go to camp. And so what a gift it is when kids who do have the chance and staff who do have the chance can take what they've learned there and create that same kind of fun and connection and affirmation and positivity in another setting. That's what we want, is for it to ripple effect much beyond our camps. You know, it's so good. So one that we do that has been really fun, and we call it Wows, and we have a bulletin board at camp, and kids or staff can write we have a little Wow pad, but you can really put it on a napkin or whatever you want. And you just write a Wow, like that. Thank you so much for waiting for me when I forgot my towel, or, you know, sometimes staff will write them about kids who really pushed themselves and challenged themselves and overcame a fear and tried something new. But it's all different things. It's about friends. Sometimes siblings write them to each other. It's the cutest thing ever when they like, thank you for being such a kind sister. I mean, it's really sweet. Anyway, so these Wows, we put them on the bulletin board, and at our daily assembly, we read a few of them and the rest of them go in people's mail. Well, this year we actually sent a Wow pad to each of our campers, encouraging them, like around the holidays, we sent it, encouraging them to write a Wow. And I've had a few parents send me photos of Wows their kids have written them. And, you know, again, it's like, it might seem kind of hokey or, you know, weird to incorporate at home, but honestly, if your child likes what they're doing at the camp, they might really be into bringing some of these kind of traditions home. Are there any other rituals? I know you guys have a couple more that you guys do that might be good for parents to try at home too.
Yes, we, onesie Wednesdays. Everybody wears onesies on Wednesday, you know, onesie pajamas with the feet in them. And so we've had kids tell us that, you know, when it's vacation time or if they have free dress at school, they'll wear onesie on Wednesdays. I love that. One of my favorites though is we have a goodnight song that the staff sings to the kids at the end of every day at resident camp. And also they sing it at 3 o'clock in the afternoon at day camp. So all the kids are going home with a sweet melody in their heads. I have to tell you the story. This summer we had a brand new counselor on staff, and during staff training, one of the very first things we teach is the goodnight song, because that's our gift to our kids when we're tucking them into bed. And this counselor, he just lit up and he said to me, "How do you know that song?" And I said, "Well, it's a song that was written the very first summer, 45 years ago, and to put our kids to bed. And we've been singing it ever since." And he said, "That song is the song that my dad sang to me since I was born." He had no idea that his dad was a camper 30 years ago, 40 years ago. And so we called him up and his dad was like, "Oh yeah, did I forget to tell you that?" So this young man's whole life, 20 years, he's been hearing the goodnight song. And that was a sweet way that camper took that home all those decades ago. But there, you know, that's a simple thing. There might be a song around a table. There might be a chant. There might be, you know, a little dance step. There's just ways of saying camp continues at home and I want to create that kind of culture here.
Maybe even just asking your camper, what do you want us to do here? You know, is there a song or a dance or something that we can do at home to, you know, just help you remember and all those good times and everything? Yeah. That's so good. Okay. What else do you have for advice for parents?
Let's see. One of my favorite things is finding out what a camper learned, a new activity that they might have learned at camp or a new interest that was sparked that they could continue at home. For example, we had a camper who loved archery. And when she went back home, she found out there actually was an archery team at her high school and really became quite an accomplished archer. Some kids, because we have a time of reflection for our campers built into the day, they went home journaling and they write about their day and they write prayers or they write just getting things they're worried about off their chest. So journaling back at home. We've had a lot of kids love outdoor cooking and camp out cooking. And so going home and teaching their parents how to make a variety of camp out meals, going hiking and backpacking after camp, maybe playing the guitar or going to the church youth group. My own daughter sparked an interest for photography last summer at camp. And this summer we gave her a really nice beginner camera for her birthday, and she's been shooting ever since. I'm so grateful that experience sparked that interest. Because I think if I had just handed her a camera and said, "You might like this," I'm not sure she would have been as interested. But to have really cool young adults be showing her and teaching her how to capture important images, she's really growing to be a great little photographer. Have you seen that from your campers too?
Yeah, it's funny. The story that I'm remembering is about a camper from many years ago, because his kids have all come to camp too. And he learned ceramics at camp, like with the kiln and everything. And it ended up really being a huge impact on his life, because he's become a landscape architect and he uses a lot of ceramics. He has his own kiln. So it's quite amazing how some of the things that you think maybe are just a hobby can end up sometimes becoming like part of your actual job. Another one of our former staff loved climbing and was really into climbing. And he now has 3 different climbing gyms, like these co-op climbing gyms in San Luis Obispo. And I always tell his story because he's one of those people, he's really good at it, really passionate about all the outdoor challenge type stuff. And he made it a life. He's now like, you know, a professional like climbing gym guy. And so I actually, you know, I think it's probably more likely to be hobbies for kids, but I do think that, you know, you get it whenever you do something new, you get exposed to some of these new things. And if your child is expressing an interest in them, why not? If it's something that's kind of low, you know, if they can join a little archery class or club or take a photography class, to keep those things up is so, so helpful, because it could, maybe they'll keep the interest, maybe not, but it's so good when they're kids to be pursuing these different ideas and things that they're thinking about.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We wanted to talk too about, I mean, this is something for me, I've just been, you know, really, really into friendship and helping kids think about all aspects of friendship, not just the making of friends, but also being a good friend, which includes trying to stay in touch even after camp. So for like us, for your resident camp and for my camp, we've really been trying to encourage kids to just, you know, that's another way to kind of keep camp going, is to keep those friendships and relationships going. So what are ideas that you share with maybe like parents with younger kids for doing that?
I so appreciate that. And I will interject. I think it's really healthy for kids, especially maybe even teens, but even little ones, to know that I have friends even outside of school, and I have friends even outside the neighborhood. It reminds me who else I am when maybe some of those friendships become, you know, strained or there's drama. Here's one person who knows me in a different way, and that helps keep me grounded. If they live close by, and if it's a day camp setting, you know, pulling together play dates where you might even play some of the games you played at camp. So it really brings back, or sing the songs you played at, sang at camp. With older kids who might have phones, it's so easy. My daughter has a text group from a group of about 15 campers. They did a beach camp for a week this summer, and they just developed a really special little friendship. And they just, every couple days, they shoot a text. And I've looked at them, they're funny and affirming and really wholesome and lighthearted. It's darling. When I was a camper, we had to snail mail, right? But there were three girls in a cabin of mine 3 years in a row. We spent 3 weeks together for three summers in a row from four different towns. And, you know, we ended up being in each other's weddings. We ended up staying friends for years and years. They're really important relationships to me. And with technology these days, it is not hard to stay in touch. And, you know, a parent needs to be a little bit close to it, depending on who they're staying in touch with. You want to make sure that those are positive relationships, but most camp relationships are. And if they can coordinate a time to maybe see each other during the year or talk together or have families meet, and then what if they get to plan to go back to the same session next year? Mm. And those ongoing friendships are priceless.
I don't know if you have this at your camp, but we actually have quite a few campers and staff who send each other snail mail letters all year.
Yes.
So do you have that same thing? I think it's like, because at camp you get into this habit of writing letters. So I love that. I actually, my 17-year-old son, who was a junior counselor, I saw a lengthy letter that he wrote to one of his camp friends that he was putting in the mailbox at home. And I thought it was amazing, because that's what my daughters always did with their camp friends. They have a few that have been their longtime camp friends, and they write these letters. And I love that it's just this connection to camp that's different than probably their connection to most of their other friends, those handwritten cards and letters.
Oh, I love that your son does that. I also think it slows, snail mail slows down the conversation. Mm-hmm. And I think for some kids, they need it slowed down so mm-hmm. they can be thoughtful. What do I want to say? What funny quip do I want to add? Mm-hmm. And then those things are so saved. My daughter has a pile, little pile of her snail mail letters. It's so different than an email that just kind of floats away. I love the, we also often will have a cabin reunion. If my daughter's friends or my son's friends are within an hour, we'll set up a Saturday night during the school year and everybody come over. And that's been a really sweet way of having kids stay connected as well.
Yeah, my son, who was a grad, you know, he just finished his last year as a camper, and he, his whole group of friends, they're really tight. They've been going through camp together, and they are all trying to plot like a ski weekend together. You know, it's going to be complicated, but they're trying to plan like a reunion with like, you know, 20 of them or something. So we'll see. I hope it comes together. But
I hope so too.
But it's even fun planning those kind of things, you know, for these kids trying to figure it out. It's
there's
really
a life skill. That's
yes. Okay, I think you had one more. You were talking about remembrance, creating kind of a remembrance thing.
It's always fun coming back from a vacation or after a year of school or after a summer camp to pull together some kind of token that's a remembrance of our kids' time. It might be a Shutterfly book of photos that were downloaded from, you know, the camp website. It might be framing an award that they earned. Or I was teasing with Audrey about this earlier, you know, hanging up that craft project that, you know, a 9-year-old's craft project might not look like a professional craft project. But when you hang that little handmade, beautiful dream catcher in a place where everybody sees it when they enter the house, wow, what a way to honor your child's creativity, even if it's not understandable or stunning, because then friends and family get to comment on it and affirm that child's creation, and then that child gets to tell their story again. And I think that's one of the best ways to honor a little one. My parents often, when I look back at what they honored that I created, they were really gracious. But there's so many ways, you know, maybe over the years collecting all the t-shirts that they had from camp and making a t-shirt blankie before they headed off to college. There's a number of ways of creating a token that reminds them of who they are at camp, the relationships they loved, those moments of feeling confident. What a sweet, sweet gift to give your kids. Mm. Audrey, I bet you've come up with a few really cool remembrances.
Well, I wish I was better. Actually, with my own kids, I've only had the bandwidth to do one scrapbook for each of them. And basically, I do that when they're a senior in high school. Cool. And I pull out like they're just like little things from each year, you know, like just the random. I mean, some of it I found like things that they wrote themselves, like from first grade. So it's like a mix of things, but like, and then their school picture for each year, and maybe it's sports team. And I just put it all, because it doesn't really need to be in frames anymore by the time they're that old. So I've done that. For camp, we do little like patches sometimes at camp, or pins for things. And some of the kids will take those and put them on a sweatshirt. And it doesn't maybe last as long as like doing a photo book, but I think that's kind of fun too. Just maybe that's a good after camp project, that if there are some little items that they've collected, to maybe put them on something or make a collage of it that they can put up in their room or on a bulletin board, or even just print out a few photos of their cabin group and just stick them on, you know, in their room or something simple like that too, if you don't want to go to too much work. But again, I'm back to my book, Off the Clock. A guy was talking about reaching a peak in Colorado, and didn't even take a photo, but took the time to like do a 360, like look, smell, really experience it. And then he took like a tiny rock, which I don't know, I guess you're allowed to do that, but he keeps it on his desk. And every time he sees that rock, it reminds him of that hike. So like maybe like a pine cone from camp, or a jar of sand if it's a beach camp, or I don't know. You could almost do those kind of things. I know some people do that from vacations too, but maybe a little item from the place that is a remembrance for you, so that when you see it, it reminds you of that place or that experience.
Oh, I love that. I love that. In fact, that does remind me. I am a camp mom. Got little small, they were pine scent, like little sprays, and put them in her kiddos' Christmas stockings. And she just put kind of a fake sticker on the outside that said something being from camp. And it was just that smell of pine, and they could spray it on their pillow or in their room. It's always been years that I thought about that, but I thought that was such a thoughtful little, you know, remembrance.
Gosh, you could just get a candle that's like scented like whatever the camp or the place or your vacation was. And that could evoke even the good memories from that place.
Absolutely.
Well, I love this. Okay, well, we've been talking for quite some time. I think I got some good ideas from you. I'm going to start doing some of these things, and it's reminding me of just how we all can kind of debrief more on our life experiences to make them richer for us.
Yes, yes. It'd be fun to hold, you know, just challenge each other to even swap ideas. When you get back from Christmas vacation, when you, after the trip to visit grandma and grandpa, after that special birthday party, or after finishing the science fair project, how can we make the learning last?
So I think it's, so your three questions, I'll put them in this episode too. They're also in episode three. But it was so great talking to you again, Sara, and I know we will be back.
Wonderful. Take care.
Thank you for joining Sara and me as we talked about ways to debrief and celebrate our children's adventures and experiences like summer camp. I hope you got some good ideas that you can use with your kids. For notes, links, and other information about this episode, visit my website at sunshine-parenting.com and search for episode 52. A lot of what we talked about in this episode was about shaping our kids' memories and helping them process experiences that they've had together. So I'm going to leave you with a quote from the book I mentioned a few times during this episode. It's called Off the Clock by Laura Vanderkam, and I will put a link to it in the show notes because I am really enjoying this book so much. This is what Laura says. Memories get shaped to form a story, and the stories become who we are.
This podcast is a proud member of Parents on Demand, a network of high-quality shows for families just like yours. Download our free network app on Apple and Android and listen to your favorite episodes on the go.